Hello everyone and welcome to this virtual poster stand. My name is Michael Hohns and I would like to show you today the short story of someone, which I call The Ring of Axon Fate. And this is a collaboration with Yadon Opatovsky from Israel. I will shortly switch off my facial video to show on the full screen the data. So every one of you knows apoptosis, and there's a multitude of initiators, mediators, inhibitors for these processes. So it's a very complex process. And initially, when there was a process found, which was Wallerian degeneration, where the distal axon degenerates or fragmentates after some stress event, which could be just a cutting injury, it was believed that this would also be related somehow to apoptosis. However, it was found that someone is required for this pathway. And interestingly, not only like a physical stress would cause someone activity into Wallerian degeneration, but also this can be a viral infection, hypoxia, chemotherapy, and different kind of inflammation. So it's a quite complex process. And also it was recently linked to ALS. So there's many interesting things to find about that yet. SARM1 contains three different domains, ARM, SAM, and T domain. And it was shown by a beautiful study of Jeffrey Milband's lab that actually NAD destruction locally would trigger the axon degeneration by SARM1. And the same lab showed also that this is done in an enzymatically catalyzed step where the enzyme itself is SARM1. So this was actually the first member of the TOL interleukin-1 receptor family to show enzymatic activity and an NAD destruction. Later on, there were others found. And that this enzymatic activity was performed by the TIR domain and is auto-inhibited by the ARM domain. So just to show here again, so we have auto-inhibitory ARM domain, the enzymatically active TIR domain, and in between there's the two SAM or SAM domains, which are important for dimerization. And before I joined the project, Yadon did a beautiful structure, crystal structure of the SAM1 and SAM2 domain. And they found actually that it forms an octameric ring, a closed octameric ring. And of course, the question was, is this also the case for the full length SARM1? And just to answer this question fast, this is the case. It was shown by Zach Miles and later on by a beautiful negative stain, which they did, which shows the inner ring of SAM, SAM, and an outer ring, which consists of what they believed ARM and TIR domain at that time. However, this was before there was a three-dimensional structure available. What was done next, actually, that when I joined the project, that we tried to do cryo-EM. And in cryo-EM, we saw directly that we don't see these beautiful rings, these double rings, as shown on the previous slide in negative stain. However, we saw something which was very similar to the inner ring of SARM1-2. So somehow the outer domains were too flexible to address them. And you see that the number of full rings are too low. So we could either collect a very big data set or we need to change our strategy. And this is what we actually did. We changed the strategy. By graphics, we were able to stabilize the outer rings and got, as you see here on the right, beautiful particles, and we could reconstruct the first 3D structure of that, which allowed the modeling of the ARM domain. and also the fitting of some entier domains. The structure was anisotropic, so the outer part of the structure was not as well defined as the inner part. But from that, what you see also on the right, we could already define a model where we have an open and a closed conformation of SAM. So it's depicted here as a cartoon with the open form in top and the closed form in at the bottom. So of course we wanted to go further and understand better what is happening here. So what activates actually SAM1? So we have a closed, which we suppose inactive ring, and an open active ring, which can, by the tier domains, by dimerization of the tier domains, actually transform the action of the NAD destruction. And by enzymatic assays, which I cannot show now for reasons of time, in cell and in vitro, including several non-functional mutants, including R mutants, R deletion, and tier mutants, we received actually quite contradictory information, which consists of the following. The closed ring is that what we find predominantly in the cell. So in cell, we found SAM1 inactive, while in vitro, we found very active SAM1. So the question was actually, what is here the difference? Is there maybe a factor, some molecule, some something on top, which might modulate why biochemically and also structurally we see different things in cell and in vitro? And also, I would like to remember you that at first in vitro we saw the open conformation of SAM1, and we needed to use graphics to get the first structure of it. So we believe that based on some metabolic or oxidative stress, the inactive form is transmitted into an active form, and that there are some factors important for activating it, and maybe also some factors for inhibiting it. And what we believe that doing our purification, we might have lost the factor inhibiting SAM1. So actually we tested a lot of factors, and to just make this long process of understanding what's happening short, here on the next slide, you see that actually the addition of NAD itself at 5 millimolar had a dramatic effect on the appearance of SAM1. So on the left, you see only inner rings as we saw initially, while on the right-hand side, you see inner and outer rings, which look similar to that what we found by graphics. So our idea was to construct a 3D structure from this NAD supplemented data. And first of all, you see that indeed, also just numerically, if you count particles without NAD, you see mostly core rings, while with the addition of NAD, you get mostly full rings. And if you then perform enzymatic assays, we see something very interesting. We get this this bell curve with eteno, with the addition of eteno NAD. We see that the rate of activity of the enzyme SAM1 goes first up, but at a certain concentration goes down again. So we have something which we call substrate inhibition. So the substrate of SAM1 itself downregulates the activity of the enzyme. And to show this in a different way, this was also performed here, a comparison between a human SAM1 with a standard pig NADase. And you see that by adding and not adding high amounts of NAD, the porcine, the pig NADase is not affected by the NAD concentration in the reaction, while human SAM1 would be inhibited at 2 millimolar NAD. From that, we reconstructed a structure and we obtained a 2.7 angstrom resolution structure. So this structure was much better than the one which we could achieve by graphics. It was much more isotropic. The outer part was well defined. We were very happy about that. And on top of that, you see the C also in direct comparison in a resolution plot. The left new data with NAD, and on the right, the old data of the graphics sample. And on top of that, we found an important difference because we were wondering, of course, if we can find the NAD itself bound and why the catalytic site of the tear domain was, there was no bound NAD. We found NAD in a, which we call inhibitory site in the arm domain. And it's actually located between arm one and arm two. As you can see here also in the video. So you see the nicotine half connected to arm one domain, while the adenosine half is connected to arm two domain. And from that, we understood that NAD is actually modulating the arm activity and stabilizing the arm domain to keep the two tier domains, which need to dimerize to perform the enzymatic action, to keep them apart. And this could also be validated with several mutants, which consists the binding site of this NAD in the inhibitory site. And from that, we derived the model, which is the following. So at normal cellular NAD concentration, you would find SAM1 in an auto-inhibited state where NAD is bound. So, however, there might be some stress-induced drop in NAD concentrations by whatever event happening, some other enzymes. This could also be shown enzymatically by playing with the NAD concentrations in cell. And once SAM1 is at a critical NAD concentration, the inhibitory site is unbound, tear domains can dimerize and reduce NAD further. So it relates in a stress-induced consumption of the remaining NAD plus, and finally into an energetic catastrophe leading to cell death. So it's a self-triggered mechanism resulting destruction of NAD, and finally thereby to energetic catastrophe and cell death. And then this triggers downstream of that, the fragmentation of the distal axon, which is called the Wallerian degeneration. And with that, I would like to thank my collaboration partners, which is mainly Jarno Opatowski and all his colleagues and co-workers. Yeah, and I'm available for your questions. Please come back to me. And I would like to know what you think of this little piece of data. Thanks a lot.